अब मैं सुदर्शन रेड्डी साहब से गुजारिश करता हूं कि वो अपना खुतबा पेश करें।
सबसे पहले तो मैं आप सब लोगों से माफ़ी मांगूंगा, इसलिए मैं जो बोलना चाह रहा हूँ या आपके सामने जो पेश करना चाह रहा हूँ वो उर्दू में नहीं है। ख्वाहिश तो है उर्दू में बात करने के लिए, क्योंकि हैदराबादी हूँ, उर्दू में बात करते हैं, उर्दू समझते हैं, लेकिन ख्यालात, आइडियाज़ प्रॉपर तरीके से आपके सामने रखने के लिए जो भी मैं आपके सामने रखूँगा वो इंग्लिश में रहेगा। और सदर साहब से रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ कि इसको उर्दू में ट्रांसलेट किया जाए और आप सब लोगों के लिए पढ़ने के लिए आपके सामने रखना चाहिए। और रेस्पेक्टेड प्रेसिडेंट सदर साहब एंड प्रो वाइस चांसलर डॉक्टर शकील अहमद, द रजिस्ट्रार ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटी डॉक्टर एम ए सिकंदर, हमारे पुराने दोस्त हैं, वेल विशर जनाब आयुब साहब, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, मेंबर्स ऑफ द फैकल्टी, फ्रेंड्स फ्रॉम मीडिया इफ एनी, ये बहुत ही मेरे लिए मुश्किल था ये लेक्चर आपके सामने पेश करने के लिए। सोच रहा था मैं दो तीन दिन से किस बात पे मैं बात करूं। मुझे मालूम है कि एक बहुत बड़ा यूनिवर्सिटी, विच इज ए स्पेशल वन एंड विच इज ए यूनिक वन, आप लोगों को सबको मालूम है कि इससे पहले एक ही यूनिवर्सिटी था, उस्मानिया यूनिवर्सिटी, जहाँ पे उर्दू में पढ़ाई लिखाई होती थी, फिजिक्स, केमिस्ट्री, इंजीनियरिंग, मेडिसिन, मैथमेटिक्स, सोशल साइंसेस, पॉलिटिकल साइंस, पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, इकोनॉमिक्स, हर चीज़ उर्दू में पढ़ाई होती थी। खैर, अभी बात हो रही थी साहब लोगों से वहाँ बैठ के, वो ज़माना अलग था, पढ़ने वाले, लिखने वाले, पढ़ाने के लिए काफ़ी प्रोफेसर्स, बहुत ही विद्वान जिनको बोलते हैं वैसे लोग उस ज़माने में अवेलेबल थे। अभी ऐसा उर्दू मीडियम में एक यूनिवर्सिटी को चलाना तो एक बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है, और ये कोई मामूली चैलेंज नहीं है। उसके बावजूद यहाँ पे जो काम चल रहा है, जो मैं सुनता हूँ, बहुत अच्छा काम हो रहा है। तो वैसे यूनिवर्सिटी में आपके सामने ठहर के कुछ बोलना, बोलने से पहले सोच रहा था, तो सोचते सोचते कुछ लिखा हूँ, वो मैं आपके सामने पेश करूँगा सदर साहब के इजाज़त से। That it is with utmost humility and I stand here to deliver this 20th Foundation Day lecture at Maulana Azad National Urdu University. Whatever role one may have played in one's life, whether substantive or not, the vital functions that an educational institution serves and the promises that such service holds of pushing forward the quest for meaning and of peaceful coexistence. and it demands reverence. The corpus of ever-expanding knowledge that we are the beneficiaries of is the result of collective effort of all mankind. Many decades ago, Paulo Freire defined education as cultural action for freedom. Freedom by the unshackling of the mind from the chains of ignorance, so that every human being is enabled to realize his, her inherent human dignity and participate in the project of helping others to do the same. The university is named after a great son of India, Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad, a selfless freedom fighter, a tireless champion of the principles of essential unity of all human beings, and the architect of a glorious phase of expansion of education in the first years of free India. As its first Union Minister for Education, Maulana Azad continued his early work in establishing great portals of learning to serve the nation that had started with his association with the movement to transform MAO College in Aligarh into modern university and the establishment of Jamia Millia Islamia University. He was instrumental in many ways in structuring the establishment of IITs in India, furthering the development of Indian Institute of Science and the establishment of Faculty of Technology at Delhi University. Nothing exemplified his understanding that education is a vital force to liberate, as his emphasis on education of women, promotion of education in the technical and scientific fields, and his insistence that education is necessarily the birthright of every human being. He was one of the rarest of the thinkers who characterized education as everybody's birthright. His contemporaries, nobody has taken the right to education to that level. To stand here and deliver a lecture on the occasion of Foundation Day of a university named after that great man is definitely an incredible honor that I can scarcely believe I deserve. Equally, it is a humbling experience. We were incredibly lucky to have people of such great wisdom and foresight who guided this country in the early years of independence. However, we must now acknowledge that after a rather encouraging beginning, we have stalled in our efforts at ensuring that birthright, the right to education to all our citizens. We have simply not done enough to ensure that we provide the quality education that all our fellow citizens deserve as a matter of their birthright. Any survey of the human condition in India reveals that vast swaths of populace continue to lead lives in which the essentiality of their human dignity is denied on account of the various discriminatory social choices. In our country, the practice of denial of access to education historically was a key factor in the construction of hierarchical society that denied the humanity of those excluded and led to visitation of horrific and unconscionable harms upon those deemed lesser by the elite. That we have failed as of yet in undoing the historical injustices in general and particularly providing quality education to all our people, and especially those who have been pushed to the bottom of the social and economic totem pole, has to necessarily be treated as a moral failure. On a personal front, I must confess to a deep sense of lack of emotional fulfillment of my own task as a human being and as an Indian who was bestowed the blessings of education. The dehumanization of others that is implied in keeping them shackled by ignorance has to necessarily be a mark of my own dehumanization. The acts of legislature establishing universities have to be necessarily interpreted as an expression of the desire of the people of India to further the shared quest for human dignity of all and the propagation of the ideals that protect it. That is especially so given the thrust of the preamble of the Constitution, specifying the promotion of justice, equality, and liberty as the reasons to be for the nation state. The desire for instantiation of justice, equality, and liberty was predicated upon the desire to promote fraternity among all individuals, which is, according to me, under a serious challenge today. Article 38, one of the directive principles of state policy, and hence by the term of Constitution itself, foundation to policy making, encodes the preambular promises and goals as the soul of the Constitution. To that extent, that establishment of a university and its growth are elements of cultural action for freedom. The establishment of MANUU is to necessarily be viewed as one step towards realization of the preambular promises and the values and goals enshrined in Article 38 of the Constitution of India. The Maulana Azad National Urdu University Act of 1996 mandated the establishment of a university that serves the objective of 1. Promotion and development of Urdu language, 2. Imparting of vocational and technical education Urdu, 3. Imparting education in conventional and distance teaching modes, and 4. To focus on promotion of women's education. The Parliament of India, in enacting the Act for the establishment of this university, has clearly made the achievement of the goals enunciated therein as essential to the project of nation building and of realization of constitutional values. The specific is to necessarily be viewed as elements of the universal, all in the service of realizing the conditions of social justice. It is with a considerable degree of pleasure I read the report of Dr. Muhammad Aslam Parvez, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of University, summarizing the achievements. The first one is that it has grown from on-campus student strength of 50 less than two decades ago to over 5,000 now. And that has opened the portals of higher education to a total strength of over 40,000. Now I stand corrected because I was discussing this issue with the director of distance education. It is written here 40,000, but I am told it is now 1,40,000 or 1,50,000. Spread over throughout the country and a part of the universe. This is clearly a significant achievement. Indeed, as the Vice Chancellor notes, such a rapid growth must appear surreal to all, those who are involved in administering the university and those engaged in teaching. The establishment of various language departments and various departments devoted to study of scientific fields, and the schools of social sciences, and the schools of computer science and information technology are clearly indicative that the university has taken large strides in providing its students the opportunity to explore and learn many areas of great importance to human and social development. I will submit that this ought to be viewed with some pride by the student community also, in as much as they are a part of university that has taken such strides in spreading the light of knowledge to conquer the darkness of ignorance. what the contents of that light are, its quality and luminance, and whether it could shine brighter are all important questions and to be raised from time to time to ensure that the university continues to strive to achieve the lofty goals set for it by the nation. The achievement of rapid expansion of student body and establishment of many departments devoted for a wide range of studies places the university on more secure foundations for much greater progress ahead. This ought to call for celebrations, and in the midst of these celebrations, I would also exhort all the members constituting the university community to reaffirm their dedication to the task of furthering the quest for freedom through knowledge. There are many different purposes which education serves in a democracy. Apart from the obvious goal of equipping youngsters to become socially and economically productive members of the society, another goal amongst the many, I may hasten to add, would be to train individuals to become full participants in the democratic discourse. A democracy is not just about periodic elections and winning by this group or that right to wield collective power. Over and above that, its chief function is to structure reasoned and reasonable debate amongst all citizens and the constituent groups to give shape to collective aspirations. The goals that are set and the policies and means that are chosen to attain those goals. By seeking to educate different classes of individuals, the nation seeks to enhance the ability of those classes to participate in that broader democratic discourse. This is one of the core aspects of freedom and vital for the assertion of and the protection of human dignity. The ability to inform the democratic discourse and to be counted as an effective voice in its vital to maintain the sense of belonging and of being a constructive participant in larger decisions. As pointed out by Amartya Sen, a noted economist, Nobel laureate, the ability to participate effectively in democratic discourse is vital for preservation of freedom and to be viewed as a vital feature of developing the society. It serves both an instrumental role and also inherently upholds the dignity of the participants. By enhancing the ability of individuals and groups to share their perspectives, their worldviews, and their particular needs with others in the democratic discourse, one also expects the sense of fraternity to grow amongst individuals and groups of them. In the latter sense, the education of specific classes of individuals or groups also ought to be seen as uplifting of others. It is by broadening the understanding of the dominant, making them alive to the striving of all classes, and the location of human dignity amongst all individuals in all groups, that one can hope to begin the process of establishing a genuinely humanized conditions. As a part of the larger project of constructing empathetic consciousness of experiences of all, it is vital for India that the experience of many of our brothers and sisters encoded in Urdu also be made available for the wider populace and be heard in democratic discourses. The objective of protection and development of Urdu is thus a project of enriching all and deepening democracy in India. That's how I look at the object of the university. On another token, I must also express my appreciation of the efforts of the university in training the students to be fluent in reading, understanding, and communicating in English. While we recognize our language of the day-to-day communication like Urdu or Hindi or Telugu and many other great Indian languages as being vital to be in touch with our heritage and maintain our cultural genius, we must also recognize that much of the rapidly expanding knowledge from humanities to the sciences is now mostly presented in the English. This is one of the challenges which we were discussing with your Vice Chancellor and other friends. A lack of comfort in use of English would restrict the ability of our youngsters to become genuine autodidacts, that is, self-learners. Knowledge in the modern world is expanding rapidly. What one learns at a university can at best be the rudiments of foundations in specialized fields of study. And the specific skills learnt can become outdated rapidly. It is imperative that the universities lay a particular emphasis on students becoming lifelong learners. The battle against the darkness of ignorance cannot be viewed as one-shot game, but as a lifelong endeavor to educate oneself and others around. Hence, it is absolutely vital for our youngsters to learn to read and communicate well, apart from Urdu and other languages, in English, to explore the tremendous corpus and advances in knowledge expressed in that language, and also share their own particular human experience on the international stage. The representation of India and its participants in global search for the truth and share futures cannot be the preserve of the few. If we are to realize the preambular promises and the exhortation of Article 38, then we need every Indian to have the necessary skills to be constructive members of the humanity conceived on a global scale. Of late, the need to educate our youngsters to be co-equal partners in the global discourse, especially about knowledge and its uses, has become even more urgent. There are many causes, but I will sketch a few of them in broad outlines. I'll take another 15-20 minutes. It's with growing unease that I finished reading a couple of books recently. I would like to share my own rudimentary thoughts about the contents of those books and what they could mean for our youngsters. The first one is titled Homo Deus by Yuval Noah Harari, and another one called The Driver in the Driverless Cars by Vivek Wadhwa and Alex Salwaker. Both points to the potential of a terrifying dystopian future and the need for collective framing of methodologies and value premises that ought to inform us in making various technological choices. In one of his many talks, the author to whom I have referred earlier, across the world, in explaining Homo Deus, Harari also paints a grim picture of deepening of inequality. According to him, the creation of a massive workless class by the development of biotechnology would mean the creation of a new caste comprising of a thin layer of super elites spanning the entire globe. He points to the fact that the inequality unleashed by the age of machines may be measured in terms of a gap of 100 to 150 years in development between, say, Bangladesh and the United States. However, according to him, in an age of rapid advances in artificial intelligence and ability to prevent death for a significant length of time, the gap between those who own and manipulate such technologies and the vast underclass would be beyond our traditional modes of quantification of inequality. This raises a question. With a large number of thorny socio-economic, political, cultural, constitutional implications for all of us in India. Unfortunately, in this country, we are nowhere close to being able to provide an education that would make all our youngsters even functionally literate, let alone equipping them with the skills of critical thinking, great felicity in use of mathematical concepts, understanding of sciences, and indeed social sciences, to mandate state action to ensure that. While the rich mostly comprised of the upper strata of the caste hierarchies or in a position to pay for quality education that approaches the best in the developed world, the poor, comprised mostly of the discriminated and marginalized, are being left behind. How do we justify this state of affairs? And if needed, as Harari claims, a new caste of the global super elite is formed. Could we be expect deepening of the discrimination that our marginalized experience? In the driverless cars, Wadhwa acknowledges the potential of emerging new technologies in bringing great benefit to us. But what he underlines is saying for many decades now that it is not the absence of technological capacity to produce that is the cause for much misery. Material and cultural deprivations among vast swaths of humanity. Rather, it is the manner in which we have chosen to define value and distribute the benefits of social action. It is absurd. On the other hand, capable too now of ushering in a jobless economy, the end of all privacy, invasive medical record keeping, eugenics and ever-worsening spiral of economic inequality, conditions that could create an unstable, Orwellian or violent future that might undermine the very technology-driven progress that we so eagerly anticipate, and we know that it is possible to inadvertently unwind civilization's progress. It is the choices we all make that will determine the outcome. Technology will surely create upheaval and destroy industries and jobs. It will change our lives, maybe for better and worse simultaneously. As I said above, even if we were to be skeptical of the extreme possibilities being painted by Harari and Wadhwa, there are many signs of the great turbulence that are being underlined by many other scholars. And these ought to make us very alert to a troublesome road ahead. On the past half a decade or so, Thomas Piketty has driven home the fact that inequality has risen to unconscionable levels across countries over the last 5-6 decades. That such rising inequality is the outcome of devil take the and more mindset, that is, I, me, and mine. That's the culture spawned by a new Spencerian advocacy of pandering to the richest as the most deserving has also been remarked upon by many scholars. Manuel Castells, in his epic, The Rise of the Network Society, raised the alarm of the global neoliberal agenda leading to the creation of a thin layer of super elite deciding how and which sources are allocated on a global scale, and this leading to vast swaths of humanity in each nation beginning to feel their economic future is uncertain. He warned rather ominously that individuals search for identity in an age of angst and anxiety. Many of us are in search of our identities. Then it will make them and groups they belong to away from a search for a place and assurance in global quest for transcendence and meaning. Instead, he visualized that security of identity will be sought in the many easily available recidivist streets of cults and monotonic viewpoints in which the visible other, quote unquote, other, is targeted as the cause for the anxieties and any economic misfortunes. Moreover, Castile also pointed to the easy possibility of exploitation of uncertainty, fear of loss of livelihoods and social status, to induce violence of one group against the other. We seem to see that all around us, don't we? Immigrants get defined as the ones taking away all the jobs. Conflicts between different religious orientations are posited as the clash of civilizations. And social justice programs are falsely described as the source of loss of economic opportunities for the allegedly meritorious and a diminution of national honor. We are seeing clear signs of many of such pathologies, are not we? Academic discourses about the previous and continued exploitation by dominant classes are deemed anti-national and subject to attacks. Presidential campaigns powered by unreserved vitriol and assertion of a right to militant use of violence to target others, quote, less than a decade ago, we witnessed a massive rebellion of youngsters in many nation states, dubbed the Arab Spring, seeking greater freedoms, liberal education, open cultures, and all of it's articulated in terms of essential humanity that is denied in unequal societies. Less than 3/4 of a decade later, that youthful quest for liberal values seems to have been easily turned by various entrenched global and local Western interests into a horrifying internecine war of unimaginable barbarity. In country after country, over the past few years, the logic of neoliberal capitalism and its emphasis on individuals' greed and desire to consume more and more as the sole edifying value. Apne liye, har cheez apne liye, has come to roost. As Edward Luce points out, no fewer than 25 democracies have failed in the past 2 decades. After examining the evidence of growing inequalities, rapid obsolescences of skills as a necessary fact of life, and massive interdependence implying inability or disinclination to protect those inside the national boundaries from uncontrolled social and economic forces, Edward says and describes the resulting degeneration of democratic politics in the following terms. There are 4 lines, I will read it for your benefit. We are taught to think our democracies are held together by values. Our faith in history fuels this myth, but liberal democracy's stronger glue is economic development. When those fruits disappear or are monopolized by a fortunate few, things turn nasty. History should have taught us that. The politics of interest group management turn into zero-sum battle. The past also tells us to beware the time of stark and growing inequality. It rarely ends well, unquote. However, the structuring of interest group management in the democratic process as a zero-sum game is not a new phenomenon that is merely a few years old. While articulation of logic of neoliberalism and its resultant political economy of alleged trickle-down was set to promote the rights of individuals, the strategy of political masters has been to use religion and other forms of xenophobic forces as a means of constructing a political base against the welfare state. We have seen this occur in the United States starting with the late 1960s and intensifying much more over recent times. We have also begun to see this occur in country after country in Europe. The logic of neoliberal discipline, which started off by positing the need to remove democratic voices, is how the economic sphere is structured, seems to carve an inexplorable path toward downwards. The voices of the multitude, the weak, and the disenfranchised that were painstakingly involved in the sphere of democratic governance through many centuries of struggle for an egalitarian order are now being pushed towards an internecine war of many small groups against each other. In the middle of 1940s, Baba Saheb Ambedkar also noted, after surveying the rubble of World War II, that liberal parliamentary democracies can become fascist, and that while they may achieve some modest economic gains, would end in legitimating on a much wider scale and with greater intensity the dehumanization of those who have been subjected historically to unconscionable social and economic injustices and deprivations. In his speech on the occasion of ratification of the Constitution, Dr. Ambedkar drew a very vivid contradiction between the grant of political freedom based on notions of equality in the political sphere and the conditions of graded inequality in the social and economic sphere. His worry was twofold. A, the graded social and economic inequalities would imply the inability of the weak and the marginalized, the lower caste and those pushed into ignorance to be able to protect their political freedoms. B, that the institutions of political democracy could be destroyed, either by the masses and or in combination with elites who eviscerate the normative content of institutions of constitutional democracy. Yet, notwithstanding his deep and intimate understanding of the extent of discrimination and dehumanization, Dr. Ambedkar had hoped that a move towards humanist society in which citizens are allowed to identify with and feel an empathetic resonance with fellow human beings might be the foundation for a more secure, egalitarian, social, democratic polity. The articulation of directive principles of state policy, and particularly the egalitarian principle encoded therein, the former demanding instantiation of social justice in all institutional national importance and walks of life, and the latter demanding that the state establish a welfare state in which economic forces and common resources are not concentrated in the hands of few to the detriment of common good, but expected to undergird the scrutiny of how the society and economy are being husbanded. Those principles were to provide the foundations of our empathetic resonance for fellow citizens and inform our voices with an urgency to eliminate the conditions that dehumanize a vast majority. In fact, he had explicitly stated that the hope that the directive principles of state policy would act as a moral principles on which policymakers would be held accountable. That was, I believe, what made the great man to say that the project of social justice were to fail, it would not be because the Constitution was badly framed, but because man was vile. On this foundation day of this university, I will not presume to have the expertise to give you a detailed and expert opinion as to how we might extricate ourselves from many thorny problems, avoiding the ethical cul-de-sac that dehumanizes us and solve the numerous age-old problems of misery of the many, while the few enjoy most of the benefits of social action even as we avoid new ones that are emerging. I urge you all to revisit the warnings of Dr. Baba Saheb at the ratification of our constitution. Inequality in the social and economic spheres, he warned, would destroy the prospects of sustenance of even political freedoms. The abandonment of egalitarian goals undergird much of the malaise that afflicts our social and national life. Consequently, our efforts as teachers and administrators of educational institutions and as ordinary citizens would be to re-emphasize and bring back to the center of our national quest of a more egalitarian and socially just order. For the students, this would be the message. By thirsty in acquisition of knowledge, wise in its application, guided by your inner core as an empathetic and a compassionate human being, with acquisition of knowledge, you must develop humility and tolerance. Learn from the mistakes of the past. Look towards a future that does not isolate us from each other, but unifies all of us and makes us realize a shared humanity. Above all, always fight for the protection of inherent human dignity of all and strive for the achievement of constitutional goals. They incorporate the finest ideals to which human beings, as individuals and as citizens of a nation, can aspire to. Hope, someone had remarked a long time ago, and I forget now who said it, is the permanent temptation of life. Hope is the permanent temptation of life. But without hope, it would also be permanent end to life. Make your lives rise to the challenge of protecting hope against the missteps of humanity. Be guided by the spirit of the words of poet Seamus Heaney. I quote, "History says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then, once in a lifetime, the longed for tidal wave of justice can rise up and hope and history rhyme." Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your forbearance. I'm grateful to the Pro Vice Chancellor and all of you and each one of you for giving me this great opportunity to share my random thoughts, which have been bothering me quite for some time. Thank you. Thank you so much.